Welcome to lecture number 2 of module 4, that is the introduction to power flow control. And in previous lecture we saw this load curve and the unit commitment problems, and also we saw that the generation economic dispatch is very much essential to reduce the cost of electricity. But to control the power flow, the obvious choice is that we should have some devices in the power system so that we can control power as well as other commodity in the system so that we can achieve our desired objective. And one of them is your FATS technology, that is your flexible AC transmission systems, and another one is your HVDC, that is called high voltage DC transmission system. We also saw the major components, especially two components we saw in the previous lecture. One is your converter and another is your converter transformer. Here just I am going to discuss other major components of HVDC systems. Another this is called smoothing reactor. Smoothing reactor, its name, it is a reactor that is used for smoothing the DC current output in the DC line. As I said, if you are having here, let's suppose we are having in this figure, this is your rectifier. We are using three phase AC system, and here the DC is coming. Then the current which will be flowing here, it is your DC current, because this side we are using another here inverter, and then we are getting three phase AC system. So the current which is flowing in this DC link must be perfect DC current, because there is, if you will see, the voltage output here, that's VD, is not a perfect DC. It is having some ripples. So to avoid that, to make this current DC, we have to use some inductor here in the line so that we can smoothen the DC current output in the DC line. It also limits the rate of rise of the fault current in the case of DC line short circuit. What happens if suppose you are not using this smoothing reactor's inductance L? If there is some short circuit here to the ground or to the other line, then it is a huge current will be flowing here, because the impedance of this transmission line is very, very less, and the voltage, that is a DC voltage, is very, very high. So this also limit the rate of rise current, because there will be some capacitor is formed here, and then we can reduce the rate of rise of fault current in case of DC line short circuit. Normally, partial or total air cooled magnetically sealed reactors are used. Here, as I said, the air-cooled reactors are normally used here to provide this smoothing reactor and provide to smooth the DC current. Dix coil type windings are used and braced to withstand the short circuit current. The saturation inductance should not be low, as I said, because if DC current which is flowing and there is some short circuit, huge current will be flow. So then we should always try to avoid the saturation reactance should not be low, it should be higher. Otherwise, again, during that period, it is a possibility that huge fault current will be flowing. Another that is important component in HVDC transmission system is your harmonic filter. Although it is not one filter, there are various filters, so that's why we call harmonics filters. Harmonics generated by converters are of the order of np plus minus 1 in the AC side, and here np in the DC side, where p is the number of pulses and n is integer. Means the harmonics which is entering here, it is your np plus minus 1, and the harmonics this side, it is your np, where p is the number of pulses. Let's suppose if you are using 6 pulse converter, means your p is equal to 6. So the harmonics which will be entering here in the AC side, it will be n is equal to n. So we are getting 5, 7, 11, 13, and so on and so forth. However, in the DC side, the voltage harmonics we are getting, no doubt in the AC side we are getting the AC harmonics current, the current harmonics. However, the DC side we are getting the voltage harmonics. And that voltage harmonics here, it is 6, 12, 18, and so on. So these are the harmonics that are in the DC side, these are the voltage harmonics, it is your current harmonic. That's why if you are going for a higher pulse number, let's suppose we are going for the 12, then P is equal to 12, we will find that we are going to get 11, 13, means automatically your 5th and 7th harmonics are eliminated and that will be not in the system. So the harmonics filters are used to filter out these harmonics because the magnitude of these harmonics are higher compared to the higher order harmonics term. Normally, this current which will be flowing here, the IH harmonics order, it is your I1 that is fundamental divided by your H. H is that is a harmonics order. Means if you are going to see what is the magnitude of your harmonics current of the 5th harmonics, it will be I1 that is a fundamental component divided by your 5. So 7th it is less 1 upon 7 of your fundamental component and so on and so forth. So the higher order harmonics, the magnitude is very small and therefore we have to provide the filters for only the lower order harmonics because the magnitude of harmonics are higher. So the filters are used to provide the low impedance path as usual to ground for the harmonic current. Whenever there is some current is flowing, harmonic current, so we can provide the minimum impedance path so that the current should not enter in the AC system and it should go to the ground. They are connected to the converter terminal so that harmonics should not enter to the AC system. Means we use here these filters so that we should not allow these should go into the AC system because that is not desirable because it will pollute your AC system. However, it is not possible, as I'll explain why. It is not possible to protect all the harmonics from the entering into the AC system. Because if you are going to design the harmonic filters, if your orders are increasing, means for you are going, let's suppose if you are comparing the harmonics for 7th and the filter which is we are designing for 13th, the cost of this filter is less compared to the 13th because the size of here inductors and capacitor will be very, very high and we have to go for the very expensive, and also you can see the magnitude of this harmonics is less because magnitude is proportional to 1 upon 13 here and it is here 1 upon 5. So we normally go for the certain level of harmonics elimination and we use the filters and remaining we allow into the system. Not only this, basically the which I wrote the formula here NP plus minus 1, it is the case when we are having a symmetrical, means these are called the characteristic harmonics. Why it is characteristic harmonic? This is calculated based on that your here whatever your voltage is appearing here, that is your like this, means there is no overlapping. Means we are having the inductances, source inductance very small, 0. Means the change of current from one wall, one thyristor or you can say, to the another one, it is a sudden we have assumed, but it is not so. There is some overlapping, means current will transfer from one leg to another leg of bridge converter, so there will be some overlapping and the voltage will be different and the characteristic, non-characteristic harmonics will be other than this harmonic. So they are entering into the system and again we have to be very cautious, so we have to go for the tuned filters or we can go for the some band filter so that we can eliminate these harmonics. So the magnitude of some harmonics are high and the filters are used for them only. As I said, those are the lower order harmonics are filtered out. These filters also provide some reactive power compensation at the terminal. No doubt the question always arises, why the reactive power is required in this DC system, because the DC there is no power factor concept. For that, what we do, basically you know this is your DC system, this is your rectifier, here the three phase system is coming and your DC output is going, so basically this firing alpha angle, and we can show that power factor at this side, that is cos phi, will be equal to your alpha cos alpha. Means once you are delaying, you are reducing the voltage, the power factor of the AC side will be the deteriorating and very poor. So we don't want that, and if you want to go for the complete control of this alpha from 0 to its certain limiting value, then you have to provide some reactive power compensator at this bus. So the reactive power requirement at the converter terminals, both side, inverter as well as the rectifier, we have to provide huge reactive power compensation. I'll come to that point later. But these filters, you can see, you can check also, if these filters are providing path for these harmonics at that frequency, so at the fundamental component they will providing the reactive power support. For example, what I am going to tell you, let's suppose we are using one filter here, this is a capacitor with this LC filter we are using. So this, as we know, here this is XL, here it is XC. Here this is providing this tuning, if you are tuning such that the impedance is minimum for this. So at particular frequency F, this will be the zero, but at the fundamental frequency, this value will be the capacitive in nature, and then it is providing the reactive power support. So you can verify that if the minimum impedance at any fundamental harmonics component FH, then at the fundamental component it will be whole, this impedance will be capacitive and it will be providing reactive power support to the system, and we require reactive power support due to the proper control, smooth control of voltage as well as the power in the HVDC link. Another major component of HVDC link is your overhead transmission lines. As we know, in monopolar operation, our transmission scheme, our HVDC link, which is most economical because we use the ground as a return. So we require only one transmission line. But the use of ground as a conductor is not permitted for the longer period. A bipolar arrangement is used with the equal and opposite current. As I discussed the bipolar operation, I also compared with the monopolar, and then we saw this bipolar is normally very feasible and it is used. But if there is one fault in any of the link, then we have to use the ground as a return path so that we can provide 50% power transport over the DC link. So then at that time we have to use the ground as a return. So we have to have the grounding as well, and we'll see that. But if you are a monopolar, we'll require one transmission line. If homopolar or it is your bipolar, we require two transmission wire. However, in the three phase, we require the three phases, different phases. Again, in one phases, maybe one or two conductors, depending on the you require bundle conductors or not. The basics, basically the principle of designing of DC overhead lines is almost similar to the AC transmission line in terms of configurations, towers, insulation, and even though seeing the voltage requirement. The number of insulators and the clearance are determined based on the DC voltage. However, this number of insulators and others are decided based on its peak value, that how much they can bear, because in DC the peak and the RMS value is same, but however in AC both are different. So they are designed on the peak value, and we go for the insulator and the clearance are assessed. The choice of conductor depends upon mainly on the corona loss and the radio interference effect. Normally we also know the corona is minimum in the DC line compared to the AC line. Another component that we have to provide the reactive power source. As such, converter does not consume reactive power, but due to the phase displacement of current drawn by the converter and the voltage in AC system, the reactive power requirement at the converter station is about 50 to 60% of the real power transfer, which is supplied by filters, capacitors and synchronous condensers. Means if you are having a DC link, let's suppose that is a for 100 megawatt, then you must require the 600 MVAR reactive power support at the both end for the smooth control, proper control of that. And this is, you have to, for that you have to put lot of reactive power supports, that is a capacitors, and also we can use the synchronous condensers if required. But also the filters we provide, as I said in the previous slide, the filters which are provided to provide the ground path for the particular harmonics will provide the reactive power support that is needed here at the fundamental component. So this we are talking the reactive power requirement at the fundamental component. So whole this reactive power sources are basically, we use the filters, we use capacitors or generators. If generators are there, they can also generate reactive power support. So are synchronous condensers. So these are the two options. So filter is always there, and here either using capacitors or some generating stations are nearby, then we can utilize the reactive power generation of that generators, and then we can go for the reactive power support. The synchronous condensers are not only supplying the reactive power but also provide the AC voltage for the neutral communication of the inverter, because this sometimes synchronous condensers are used, because synchronous condenser gives some AC sinusoidal generators, and that can be used for the your inverter operation, because the inverter operation is the big problem in your HVDC. Due to harmonics and transients, a special design machines is used. Here we use the synchronous condensation special design due to the harmonics, because harmonics are there and also the transients are there. Another component, that is your earth electrodes. As I said, we have to use the ground as a return if you are using bipolar or homopolar, if one pole is out, or if you are operating as a monopolar, then you use the ground as a return. So we should have a proper grounding schemes, so that we can, here you can see the earth resistance at the upper layer here is your 4000 ohm per meter, means the resistivity of earth here is this, and the electrodes cannot keep directly on the earth surface, because we cannot keep there, because there is a lot of problem and the resistivity is more. So we have to go deeper and deeper so that we can provide the minimum impedance. So electrodes are buried into the earth where the resistivity is around 3 to 10 ohm per meter. You can say a surface 4000 almost. And again, it depends upon the area to area, it depends upon the soil, it depends upon several other factors. To reduce the transient over voltage during the line fault, and also gives low DC electric potential and the potential gradient at the surface of earth. The location of earth electrodes is also very important, because possible interference to the DC current ripple, to power lines, communication system of telephones, railway signal, etc. So that may create problem. Also the metallic corrosion of pipes, cables and sheath here, that is also it is taken into the consideration, and also we have to go for here the public safety. The electrode must have the low resistance, means it should be less than 0.1 ohm and buried even though sometimes 500 meter into the earth. So interconnection of HVDC transmission system into the AC system. Since it is efficient and economical to have AC generation and the distribution, but for the transmission and control of power, HVDC here links can be used. No doubt the generation, I am from very beginning I am saying there is no alternative to generate and the distribute AC, because we have the very reliable generations, three phase, efficient, robust, and also the utilization part are we are having the similar type of it. So only option that we can have the transmission system, that is a combination of your AC and the DC, and here the AC and DC sometimes is very beneficial if you want to control the power in the transmission line. The main area of application based on the economics and the technical performance are the long distance, here the bulk power transmission, means just I will come to that point. Here suppose one area is here, another is here, and it is very far, so we can transfer bulk amount of power over this HVDC line, and it is not possible to transfer bulk amount of power on AC transmission line if the distance is quite far, means more than 500 kilometers, it is very very difficult. We have to go for the compensation, etc., and the cost would be more than HVDC line, so it is better to use HVDC. Also the asynchronous connection of AC system with the different frequency, means we can connect the two systems here, means if it can operate at the 50 hertz, another can operate here at the 60 hertz, and we can have the HVDC link here, and it is we can operate this. However, in AC it is not possible, as I said, the frequency of throughout the interconnected system should be same, and it will be, but here in the DC system it is possible. Basically the invention, the first HVDC transmission line was basically realized on this principle. The first HVDC line, that is a Gotland between the Sweden island to the mainland Sweden, it was more than 70 kilometers. It was not possible to have perfect AC transmission tie line. Then they went for, and again, though both systems were operating with the different frequencies. So the DC was option. So here you can use asynchronous connection or operation. That is means two frequency system can be connected through the HVDC lines. That is another great advantage. Another advantage is, and that is a very, very important, that we can control here the, and stabilize the power system with the power flow control. As I said, the current in the transmission lines flows according to the impedances. You cannot have direct control over the electrons or current flow unless until you use some device. So that's why here HVDC can control, even though not only control, it can reverse the power, and also it can stabilize the power system with your power flow control. Based on the interconnection, the three types of HVDC links are possible. First one is your HVDC transmission system, where bulk power is transmitted from one point to another point over the long distance. So this is called your bulk power transmission system, and here it is the bulk power is transmitted over the transmission line, that is very long transmission line, from one point to another point. Another type here I can say it is one, here it is your two. Two is your back to back. Back to back is operation of the DC link. Basically here the transmission line is almost negligible, very small. Means here if you are having, let's suppose this is your converter station, this distance between this distance maybe even though less than 1 kilometer, maybe less than few hundred meters, right? Maybe in same substation here this inverter here will be lying. So main purpose of here, it is at one substation. Only the option here that we can control the power here. So normally the two regions are connected by back to back, means we can connect the power here by the two areas, and also we can control the power over these regions. So this is here the back to back DC line with the rectification and inversion is carried out in the same converter stations with the very small or no DC line, as I said. This is basically used to control the power and stabilize the system. It also used sometimes to connect the two different frequency system, that is possible. So, and third is your parallel connection of AC and the DC links, where both AC and DC lines are running parallel. It is mainly used to modulate the power of AC line. Due to its fast control, DC line can improve the transient stability of the system. Means here one area is this, another area is this. Let's suppose we are having a AC transmission line, this is your AC. Now we can have a parallel DC line here. Let's suppose we have DC line here and in this area. So with the control of power here, P that we can control, here we can modulate the power on this line, and then we can improve the transient stability of the system. And basically it is used to stabilize the two areas during the emergencies and various fault conditions. So these are the basically the basic motive of your HVDC systems. Now the choice of voltage is decided by how much power you are going to transfer. Means what will be your, the voltage of your DC link. This is the voltage we are talking. Let's suppose normally the back to back we have 500 kV system. Then we want, let's suppose how much current we are flowing, what will be the losses. So the depending upon your power requirement, we decide the voltage, and then we can go for other designing for insulators. We can calculate the losses, we can calculate the performance in terms of voltage drop, regulation, efficiency, and then we can go for similar fashion. Basically this is similar to your AC transmission voltage selection procedure. Now let us see the another part, that is your analysis. So here for the analysis, let us see here, you know that's VDDC voltage of from the converter side. Here it is nothing but it is called VDO cos alpha. In that case, if you are assuming there is no overlap. Overlap here, U is overlap angle, and this VDO is again defined at the when alpha is 0, what is your DC value is coming? So this is basically nothing but 3 under root 3 Em upon pi, normally it is defined. So if you are assuming the overlap, as I said, overlap means here what you happen, you are the DC voltage which you are getting here like this, but it is not true. Normally we go here like there is some overlap between these two, and we can write the VC, we can define the DC output voltage here, the VDO upon 2 cos alpha plus cos alpha here plus U. If you are putting U 0, you will get the same here, this expression. That can also be written here in terms of VD DC voltage here, and we can write the VDO cos alpha minus RC ID. ID is the current which is flowing here in this DC line, and the RC is nothing but your 3 upon pi omega L, and omega L is your source inductance, or we can write 3 upon pi XC. So this whole VD, that we are controlling the alpha by changing alpha, means we are controlling this component, and this component is called VDO cos alpha, that's why I have made a arrow that we are controlling, and this R is called your commutation resistance. XC is called your commutation reactance, and then we are getting the VD, that is actual. So whole your converter, basically this is the replacement of your this converter, that is a bridge converter part here that we are having here. The three phase AC is coming, and here we are DC. So this converter is basically replaced by this one, and here we are getting this VD as usual. This is for your rectifier side. Similarly, we can go for inverter side, and same expression can be used, because the inverter side here, they are connected, as I said, it will be connected like this here, and the DC is coming, and three phase here AC is coming. So what is coming here, we are taking this is a plus and minus, then this is your negative, I have made here negative sign, and then we are going to analyze, and we'll get here the VDI, this inverter voltage here, I can say VDI is your again the DC voltage here in terms of cos beta if you are using, so I can write this much. So this is your VDI cos beta plus RC minus ID, you can say this is plus is going to be added. But if you are using your gamma, what is happening, this is your positive, then it is a negative, and this here is a negative resistance is coming, means minus RC is coming here. So you can say in terms of gamma. Gamma is nothing but is advance angle, means your beta is your minus alpha, and your gamma here it is nothing but your pi minus alpha minus u. So it is your gamma, and that is called commutation margin angle. So this is your equivalent circuit of inverter here, just we have replaced by this. Now incorporating both two, we can have a circuit like I can show you here. You can say this is your inverter, this complete your inverter, this is your rectifier. Here now I have replaced the VDO R as the rectifier side, I means inverter side, RCR means rectifier commutation resistance, RCI is a inverter side commutation resistance, and RL here is the resistance of the DC line, and the ID current is flowing. Here we are providing this AC. Here it is, we are getting the AC from that side, and the power is flowing. So this is your equivalent circuit, and based on that we can now calculate the current in this line will be your now this alpha minus your this voltage source divided by your RCR here plus RL plus minus RCI. Why we are doing RCI? If you are using here beta, then it is a positive. If you are using the gamma, it is your negative. So here the gamma, negative source for the gamma, as we saw our expression here, it was negative. You can say here it was negative, here it was a positive. So based on that, we have to go for here the control mechanism, that is a controlling the firing angle of valve can control the output of converters, and thereby the power control over the HVDC. It should have the following feature, means we have to now design the control, how it is doing the control, let us see. Means we are having converters, that is a rectifier as well as inverters, means two converters we are having, and then we have to control to meet our desired objective, that is we have to control the power. So first here, the first requirement, first feature is the control should not be sensitive to the normal variation of voltage and the frequency of the AC system. We know the voltage is keep on changing because the voltage load is changing, voltage is changing, frequency is changing, load is also changing. So there are some normal variation. So our control should not be very sensitive to those variation. If there is a certain variation, of course it should take care of. But the very small and the normal variation, it should not be sensitive. Second is your control should be fast. We want the fast control, reliable and easy to implement, and it should be very simple. It should not be very complicated, otherwise it will create another problem in the complication. Third one, that it should have the continuous operating range from the full rectification to full inversion. Means I want to show that here your, this is, let's suppose this is your ID, this is your VD, so this is your rectification because the VD and ID, so it should have the complete operation in that two range, from here rectification operation, here inversion operation, voltage becomes negative, current in the same direction. So it should have the continuous, there should not be any discrete operating range. The control, that is fourth, control should be such that it should require less reactive power. As I said, the reactive power requirement is very huge in the DC system because it is 50 to 60% of the normal rated power supply of that DC transmission. So we should have the control scheme in a such a fashion that requires minimum reactive power support. Another feature, that under steady state condition, here steady state conditions, the valve must be fired symmetrically. Means we have to fire the valve symmetrically, so that here unsymmetrical firing may create lot of harmonics. So we should fire the symmetrically so that harmonics can be minimized. The control should be such that it must control the maximum current in the DC link and limit the fluctuation of the current. Means in the DC link, the current fluctuation can be minimized. Our controller should be in such a fashion. The power can be controlled independently and smoothly, which can be done by controlling current and or voltage simultaneously in the link. Means the PDC, it is your VD into ID. So we can control the DC power either controlling VD or controlling ID, or we can controlling by both. So that is possible. And control, that is the other feature, that control should be such that it can be used for the protection of the line and the converter. Means whenever there is some problem in the system, then we can control in a such a fashion that we can save the converters and we can also protect the whole the transmission line as well. For example, let's suppose here you are having a rectifier. The DC line which is going from here three phase, if there is a short circuit DC, huge current will be flowing. So if we can control very smoothly, we can reduce this voltage to zero, what will happen, we can take it out and then line can be avoided from the damaging. So because of the circuit breaker here, we are not having any circuit breaker in this line, because the DC circuit breaker is again big problem. So we can control this one in the very efficient way, and then we can achieve our protection scheme by controlling this here converter valve. So it should be such that we can protect the line as well as the converter from the severe faults and other abnormal conditions. So already I discussed the ID we can control here. So for the maintaining the safe commutation margin, gamma is used as the valve variable instead of beta. Why it is so? You can see, if I'll explain here, basically this is your commutation voltage of any valve. The alpha which is start from here, the beta we measure from here. What happens here, the measurement of beta here, let's suppose you have measured the beta firing, you are fixing this value, but due to the certain problem, this value is reduced, and then your commutation from one valve to another valve should not take place in the desired value. Then what will happen, this will be going in the another zone and the commutation failure may occur. So instead of this beta, what we do, we fix this value gamma, that it should be, we can maintain the gamma minimum, and then we can calculate our beta accordingly, so that we can have the proper commutation. So the commutation in the inverter side is very important, so we have to go for the gamma rather than beta, so use gamma very carefully. But you can see, if you are using gamma, here it is minus, What happens? There may be possibility this resistance in a such a fashion that here denominator may be zero and this ID will be very, very high. And that is the case of your resonance. That is a very, very dangerous condition. So, the control here, let us see, to control power in two terminal DC link, it is a desirable to have current control in one converter and the voltage control in second converter. Means we have to control the voltage because you know power here is your V into I. So, power can be controlled here as well as here. So, one converter can control current, another can control voltage and then we can operate the system very efficiently. To increase the power in the DC link can be achieved by either reducing alpha. Suppose you want to increase the power, P here it is Vd into Id. So, if you are reducing alpha means your Vd is increasing and that will also improve the power factor. Or by increasing gamma or beta which will worsen the power factor and the higher loss in the number valve circuit. Means if you are increasing this you can go far no doubt, but here there is also possible that you can increase the current. And to increase the current if you will see what you have to do here, this value must be reduced. This normally values are fixed because they are once converter is designed it is fixed. So, only option that to increase the ID you have to here this gamma must be also increased or here beta must be increased. So, if beta is increased here then what will happen? The power factor becomes worse and worse. If you are firing here very close to 0 then it is a power factor will be unity. So, with this increasing gamma or beta the power factor will be poor and there will be more losses in the Schnabel circuit and other circuits as well. So, this option is better to go for reducing alpha, but alpha has also limitations, you cannot go alpha 0. So, normally we can go up to alpha minimum by low and thereby if you have reached that limit, if you want to still increase the power then of course you don't have choice and then you have to go in this side to increase the current. So, therefore, it is required to operate the inverter at minimum. Here you can see increasing is not possible, so it is try that we can operate this ID fix, this gamma is fixed so that we can have the better power factor, operate the minimum extinction angle at the inverter and constant current control at the rectifier is the better voltage regulation than the operation with the minimum alpha at the rectifier and the current control in the inverter. So, what here I am just going to tell, so we can operate the minimum extinction angle here, thus we can at the inverter end and the constant current control at the rectifier end is the better voltage regulation than operating the alpha minimum at the rectifier and the current control at that one. So, what we do, it is always, it is better to CC current control at the rectifier end. We are can control the current from the rectifier end and then we control the basically the minimum extension angle at the inverter end. So, this is the better choice. To avoid the commutation failure, it is economical to operate inverter at the constant extension angle. Means extension angle that is a gamma is here constant, it is called CEA control that we can fix the minimum where the commutation in that degree commutation can take place properly. However, the main problem with the CEA control is the negative resistance characteristic of the converter which makes it difficult to operate stably if the connected with the weak AC system. As I said here due to your this minus RC if it is weak then it may create lot of problem. Under the normal condition rectifier operates at the CC as I said and the inverter at the CEA control. Means we see that we should go for the CC at the rectifier end and inverter should go for the CEA control. Let us see here. What is this? This is your ID x axis, this is a DC voltage your y axis and this is your the constant current control. That is your rectifier is doing and this is here your inverter operation here is a CEA. So, here as I was telling that the CC this is your rectifier and this is your inverter is operating. other side we'll see later why we have made some modification. Again, let us come to this point. So with this control, let us examine the effect of AC voltage on the DC link current. Means I said our controller here, that the CC here, constant current, this is your ID, this is your VD, and then we have the CEA. So CEA is for your inverter and this CC for your rectifier. So again, to analyze this behavior, then we can modify the characteristic accordingly. Increase in the rectifier voltage. Let's suppose there is an increase in the rectifier, AC side voltage has increased. The current in the link will increase. Why? Because this ID, if you remember this ID, I wrote here the VDR cos alpha minus VDI cos gamma divided by some resistance. So if this value VDR increase, the current will increase. To control the current in the rectifier end controller, what it will do? It will try to delay. If it is increased this value, what will this value will be? This alpha will also increase so that this value can be decreased. So this will also increase. And if it will increase, what will happen? That is very, very bad. If this will be increased in the delay angle, while inverter and control will maintain at the CEA, let's suppose this is a gamma is constant, it will do. But this increase will deteriorate your power factor. We don't want that. So decrease in alpha will be worsen here the power factor, and generally it is controlled up to some fixed angle, and here tap changers are used. So here if you are increasing this value, then your current will increase. To increase this, whole cos alpha value must decrease, and to decrease cos alpha must be increasing here, that is means more delay, and due to this delay the power factor will be poor. So what we can do, we can go only up to certain fixed value. Here it is not increased, here it is a delay in the alpha will worsen. Another, let us see the feature. If the increase the voltage, inverter end voltage is increased, means this VDI is increased, then current here will be reduced, because this value is increased, this is keeping constant. So here we are, this ID is reduced, and to maintain that current, this inverter side, rectifier side controller will try to increase this whole component. Here it cannot do here, so what will do, this alpha will try to reduce, and it will go up to alpha minimum, which is required for the complete firing of the valve. If still current link is less than the referent current, then the tap changer is also operated to increase the AC voltage of the rectifier. So we can use this one again to increase, and then it is your alpha minimum, it will reach up to that angle. So what, as I said here, this is your CC, and then if your voltage increase, so we can go for here alpha minimum control here in this end. Means if current which is going to increase or decrease, means current is reduced here, then we have to go for here. This is your, let's suppose, set value. So if current is reduced here, the case will be different case. Case will be either reduction in the rectifier voltage or increase in the inverter voltage. In that case, we have to go for alpha minimum here, as I said, means we have to go alpha minimum in case of your rectifier. Now let us take a case here to understand this. Let's suppose your converter voltage is decreased, means your ID which was here, it was your VDR cos alpha minus inverter voltage. So if this voltage is decreased, what we have to do? We have to increase this, and alpha must again be delayed, and then it must be operate to alpha minimum value, otherwise this again the commutation will be not taking proper place. And then even still it is not possible, then we have to use the VDR value to change the tap, because the alpha control is very, very fast than the tap change control. So first we have to go for the firing of thyristors, either inverter end or rectifier end, then we have to go for other control, that is a tap changing here. So you can say again, for this we are going for alpha delay. So this was your CC characteristic, this was your CA characteristic, but if the current was less, then we went for here, you can see this is your called alpha minimum control. Now, so this is your complete characteristic of this one. Now again, what we can do, we can, let's suppose, want to revert this. Means if your rectifier which is operating as inverter and inverter is operating this, we normally provide this alpha here D margin angle. Means there is a possibility, you can see the second case here, this case here, as I said, decrease in the inverter voltage. If the inverter voltage is decreased, the DC current in the link will be increased. Rectifier and controller will increase the delay angle alpha, and the decrease in alpha is worse than the power factor. Generally, it is controlled up to certain angle again, thereafter tap changing is used. Again, if the tap changing is also exhausted, what we have to do? Now we have to shift that option from your inverter rectifier side to inverter side. And for that, we provide certain margin here, and that is called your current margin. Means in the normal here, this is your normal characteristic here. But if your current is still decreased more, then what we can do, we can use another here CC of the inverter end, and then this is your proper operation. Why it is required, now I'll again explain. Let's suppose you have only this. This is your alpha minimum and you have CEA. There is a possibility that your alpha here decreases further, and where it is not possible, you are here. So this will be not cutting. So in that case, it is always we have to cross section here so that this is your operating point. Let's suppose this, the voltage is further delayed, further decreased, and your characteristic is here. You can see your this angle and this angle is not intersecting. So we have to have here this now shift from the current controller of rectifier to the inverter side, because the intersection will be here. To understand it clearly again, what I want to say, let us see, this is your ID, this is your VD, this is your characteristic alpha minimum, here your CEA. What happens, let's suppose alpha minimum we are operating, so these are the alpha minimum characteristic. If there is a sudden drop in this rectifier side voltage, then you are operating alpha minimum this characteristic. What happens? This is not intersecting. So we want that we should change the current controller from rectifier to inverter end, because we should have a operating point here, and we provide that current margin. It is normally the 10% of the rated current of the link. So you can see this is the characteristic that is in the rectification operation. This is A, B, C, D, E, that is a rectifier end, and here H, G, F here. Why we are doing, you can say, once we are transferring from the inverter to another operation, then the inverter will become rectifier. So this is alpha minimum and this CC, and similarly you can see here, now this is your this zone here. Means the inverter which was operating earlier, the rectifier which was operating as inverter here, now it is operating as a rectifier, and it is changed. So this is basically the power reversal control characteristic, and this is basically your controller characteristic. So the basic control, again we are some modification we have made based on our requirement. These modifications basically related with why we are going for all. Now let us explain with this example. What happens, there is a possibility that here if you are operating here, and this characteristic, the slope of this characteristic may be equal to the CA characteristic. So in this, if your characteristic like here, this is coming like this, what will happen? Then you have a not only one point, you have a region of your stability, and then it will be oscillating in this zone here, because there is no only one point intersection, because the both characteristics are lying. So what will be the point of operation? Then it will be oscillating between these CC2. So to avoid this, what we do, we try to do some here sloping here, so that even though this is reduced here, you will have another point here. It should not be parallel to this. So we go for some here, this can be your constant beta, here beta, this is your alpha minimum control, this is your CEA control, here the constant beta control. Or sometimes we go for the constant voltage control is also possible. We can go for some constant voltage, and then we can go for this. Also during the AC fault at the inverter end cause commutation failure, and it is important to reduce the stress on the inverter valve. It can be achieved by the low voltage dependent current limit to rectifier control characteristic. Here you can see we have provided this another modification, because when there is AC fault, AC during inverter operation commutation failure, so there will be huge stress on the converter. So what we go for the minimum current operation, we have reduced the current rating of the rectifier so that it should not maintain that current, and then we can again, this is called low voltage dependent current limiter here that we have applied. So we can get another characteristic. This is basically modified characteristic with the VD call, the voltage dependent current limiter. So this is your control characteristic of HVDC link, means we are having both side of controllers. Another, there is a recently new development in HVDC that is called HVDC light. This is very light in the weight and it is very popular and very efficient. Now let us see what are the major problem in HVDC light. Is that the in conventional HVDC technology, which I was discussing earlier, mostly used for the long distance point to point transmission, or it is back to back, or it is to modulate the AC power in the interconnected two regions. It requires fast communication channel between the two stations. As I said, if one is controlling the control, another is controlling the voltage, it can be changed. So it will be a fast communication link between these two channels, two converter ends are required. Also huge reactive power requirement, as I said, it is approximately 60% is required. Thyristors valves are used, of course, nowadays modern HVDC technology, they are using GTUs, and then we can go for the various other pulse width modulated control. In thyristor, basically line commutated converters were used, and then we have to go for the commutation circuit design, and this is a very bulky and very complex, and reliability is lost. But somehow here, there are some changes here now, again the, due to the GTUs, and of course it is very expensive, but people are using the GTU thyristors for the HVDC technology. On the other hand, this HVDC line has a following advantage. The power transmission through HVDC utilizing the voltage source converter, again, here in HVDC we use the current source converter. Why? We use inductor, smoothing inductor, means current is constant. In voltage, we use the capacitors, voltage source converters, with the insulated gate bipolar transistor. We use IGBT. So this is a transistor based concept. Here it is your thyristor based, whether you are using conventional thyristor or you are using GTUs, because gate turn off thyristors, they are also thyristor based. So here we are using transistor, which extinguishes the current more faster and with the less energy loss than the GTUs. So it is efficient. It is economical even at the low power range, means earlier it was for high power it is economical. If you see for AC system, if you are, as I said, this is your distance, this is your cost, then for the DC, for AC this is this, for DC it is this. So this was the distance, the DC was the cheaper after certain distance, and this was approximately 600 to 700 kilometers. But here, even though it is at the low power range and even though for the shorter distance, this technology is even though feasible and the economical. In this case, real and reactive power control can be done independently in the two HVDC light converters. Here again, the AC voltage control is very rapid. There is a possibility to connect passive loads. You know, in the HVDC, it is not possible. In HVDC, what we do, we connect the two systems. Here, one converter, another inverter, because here your, as I said, this is your rectifier or one end, here we are having DC, here. So we never connect the load in between of this line, because here the current will be the different sense by this inverter and this one. So it is very difficult, this is AC, so what happens, we have to connect the AC system here, we cannot connect the load in the passive loads here, but here we can connect. And again, we don't need the fast communication between the two converter stations. It operates in the fourth coordinate. In the actual, what I can see, you can is this is your two quadrant operation in this normal conventional. This is your VD, this is your ID, and we can operate the conventional thyristor in the two coordinate, coordinate number 1 and coordinate number 4. But this we can operate in the your 2 and your 3 also. So it is a four quadrant operation and it is very flexible in terms of coordination. In this case, we can use the pulse with modulated scheme, and so that we can improve the power factor as well, and that's why it is very reliable. And reactive power requirement can be minimized using the pulse with modulated control scheme. The opportunity to transmit any amount of current or power over the long distance and via cable. So it can amount any amount, it can transmit any amount of current over the long distance via transmission line or your cable. So let us see other advantage that here HVDC light, this is as I said, low complexity thanks to fewer component. In the conventional, we go for the several components like the filters, like we are going for the smoothing reactors, we are going for other various auxiliaries there. Here we require the fewer components, so it is a reliable and low complexity. It is a small of course, and it is very compact. Here losses are less, so the cooling system is very small, so it is very useful, and it can be used for the windmills. That is very important. Means windmill, you know, they are very remote and they are transmitting very less amount of power, so we have to connect whole power and then we can transfer over the DC line. We can use HVDC light very efficiently. And of course, it can also offer the asynchronous operation as the conventional thyristors, HVDC transmission line using the conventional thyristors, so it can also do that purpose. So we can see this HVDC light is another alternative, although this technology is existing. You can see the first HVDC light, the pilot transmission, that is for 3 megawatt plus minus 10 kilovolt, was here operated in 1997 in Sweden. First commercial project of 50 megawatt, 70 at the voltage level 70 kilovolt, and this was feeding to the 72 kilometer here, and in 1990. So again, there is a lot of development, and we are expecting in the future we can have the HVDC lights, and they will be replacing, although if already the HVDC in the conventional transmission lines are existing, it is not possible to replace, but the new future projects may be based on the HVDC light if the technology will be mature and it will be the economical. So in this now lecture, now I can recap that we saw that HVDC transmission line can improve the system performance by controlling the power. We can even though reverse the power. We also saw the various components, those are required in HVDC transmission system. We also saw that the control schemes, that we will have the good communication link between these two, the dry rectifier end and your converter end together, and so a fast communication link is required. We require reactive power support used in the conventional, so the HVDC light can alleviate the several problems of your conventional here. No doubt the HVDC transmission system, as I said, they are introducing the harmonics into the system. Even though whether you are going for HVDC light or your conventional HVDC transmission system, both will introduce the harmonics, but this will introduce less compared to that previous one. But still they are introducing the harmonics. So although if harmonics magnitudes are less, so need not to worry, but if these values are very high, so it may be dangerous and that may create resonance in your system. So with this HVDC is one alternative, and it is only used in the transmission system. The generation here the AC, distribution is AC, only the transmission can be your DC part, and it can be helpful in the several ways. In India also we have the several schemes. As I said, we have HVDC link between Dadri to Rihand. We also having the several back-to-back connections like we are having in the Vindhyachal, because we are connecting our northern region to your western region. So we are having all these connections, and then again the purpose is to control, to make the system, to make the grid very rigid, reliable, and the very efficient operation. Thank you.